إن الحمد لله تبارك وتعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. وبعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وبعد، as you noticed, I would like to, inshallah, every time to recite in the prayer, in Maghrib prayer, the surah that we're going to recite, inshallah ta'ala. Tonight is our Quran halaqa, as everybody knows, and before the recitation part, we will have a brief tafsir, inshallah. It is the second lesson of Surah Nuh. Last time we talked about the da'wah of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam and the principles of his da'wah and how his people responded to him and what will happen in the day of Qiyamah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him and will ask his people. They will reject that, they will actually deny that Nuh alayhi salam came to them, alayhi salam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be witnesses to Nuh alayhi salam and against his people that he actually came to them, because we found the story in the Quran. Today, inshallah, Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam is telling his people, after he told them the principles of the da'wah, today he is talking to them about the importance of istighfar. And before going into the ayat, I would like to share with you the story of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, radiallahu anhu. You know the four imams? One of the most famous imams, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Hanbali, right? And in the past, people didn't have Facebook, they didn't have WhatsApp, there's no emails, there's no even photos. So they know Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they love him, but they haven't seen him. Like a lot of people who live, for example, away from his city. He used to live in Baghdad. Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu anhu was born in Baghdad, in Iraq, and he lived there for his whole life, and he died over there. But one time he went out of his city, away from his city, he was traveling, radiallahu anhu, and people don't know him by face, but they love him, and they appreciate his knowledge, and they would love to be honored with meeting Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So one time he was traveling, he got into a masjid and he decided to sleep in the masjid. And we call those people who are traveling Ibn al-Sabil. And when Ibn al-Sabil is traveling and he wants to stay in the masjid, it's his right. And it's also his right to give him from our zakah if he needs some financial help. It's one of the 8 branches of zakah, Ibn al-Sabil. Ahmad ibn Hanbal was sleeping there. But that brother who cleans the masjid, he didn't feel actually good, and he came to him, he kicked Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, who was sleeping, kicked him and woke him up. You can imagine how he dealt with him, and he doesn't know that this is Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad ibn Hanbal woke up, and then what's up? Said to him, what's up? He said, like, go outside, you're not supposed to sleep in the masjid, go outside. Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu anhu went outside and just sat down at the door of the masjid. Then the guy came outside and said to him, you're not supposed to be here. Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, I'm outside. What else you want from me? And he didn't say to him, you don't know who I am? I'm Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He didn't say anything. He was humble. Then the guy actually was a little bit harsh on him. It was very harsh actually. And he dragged Ahmad ibn Hanbal from his legs and he put him in the middle of the road. And you're not allowed to sleep here. It was very tough, right? And then, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, now what I'm going to do? What is the solution? A guy passed by him who was a baker. He said to him, okay, now you can come to my store, just sleep in my store until the morning. And then you can find a place for yourself. Ahmad ibn Hanbal went with him, slept in his place. In the morning, the guy walked up to bake his bread and this stuff. And Ahmad ibn Hanbal was watching him. The whole time he was baking and saying, Astaghfirullah, 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 the whole time. Like he never stopped. And you know, when you make a lot of istighfar, your tongue becomes dry and sometimes you get bored or you forget. Huh? Ahmad ibn Hanbal said to him, like, you didn't get bored. You just make istighfar the whole time, your whole day making istighfar. He said, yeah, that's something that I used to do. Because you have to train yourself. And نفسك الطفل إن عودته شب على حب الرضاع وإن تفطمه ينفطم يعني. You have to train yourself. Whatever you want to do, train yourself on it. So he trained himself. Mahabba told him, okay, tell me something that you gained out of making that istighfar. He said to him, مَا دَعَوْتُ اللَّهَ بِدَعْوَةٍ إِلَّا اسْتَجَابَ لِي. He said, one thing that Allah gives me is whenever I make dua, He responds subhanahu wa ta'ala right away. And He gives me what I want, except for one da'wah. إِلَّا دَعْوَةً وَاحِدَةً أَنِّي دَعَوْتُ اللَّهَ أَنْ أَرَى الْإِمَامَ أَحْمَدَ بْنَ حَنْبَلَ. Said to him, the only one da'wah, only one dua is that I ask Allah that I want to see Ahmad ibn Hanbal. I love him, but he doesn't know him. Right? He said to him, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saqa ilayka Ahmad ibn Hanbal min rijlayhi. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has dragged Ahmad ibn Hanbal from his legs to your store. That's because of what? Of his? Astaghfirullah, 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 astaghfirullah. It's so important, right? To make istighfar. Al-Imam al-Hasan al-Basri also, radiallahu anhu, he was a big scholar from al-Tabi'een, and he has his own madhab. A lot of people don't hear about his madhab, but he had a madhab, radiallahu anhu. It's not so famous like the four imams. Three people came to him, and they asked three different questions. You know, when people come to the imam, they have some problems, they think that the imam has a solution for everything, but he actually doesn't. But sometimes there are some solutions in the Quran, and he gives them the solutions. A man came to him, yashku al-faqa. He is poor, he wants to find a better job. So what the Imam is going to do with this? He can't give you a job. Then he said to him, Al-Hasan al-Basri, your solution is to make istighfar. Just to go and increase istighfar. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, forgive me all the time. Another guy came to him, شَكَ لَهُ قِلَّةُ الزَّرْعَ. Like I have a garden, but it doesn't produce a lot of like fruits and vegetables. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide me more in my garden. Then what am I going to do? Like, I can't do this. So go back and increase your istighfar. Third guy came to him, I am married and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not granted me children yet. So what I'm supposed to do? Go and make istighfar. People came to Al-Hasan al-Basri, like three people came to you with three different questions and you give only one single answer. He said, haven't you read Surah Nuh? When he said to his people, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا. These are the ayat that we're reading inshallah tonight. I said to him, Ya Rabb, go and ask Allah's forgiveness because he's ghaffaran. He didn't say he's ghafir. Ghafir, he just forgives once in a while, like once every two, 3 days. Ghafir. Sometimes he forgives. It's a ghafir. But ghaffara means he forgives a lot. Frequently forgiving, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's ever forgiving. Every day. You make a sin and just to go back to him, he will forgive you. And then he says, يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا. He will send the rain from the heavens on you like showers. He will shower you with blessings and barakat. He will provide you more. وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ. And he will provide for you children and wealth. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. And then he will make for you gardens and rivers. Right? In these gardens, it will be beautiful. So these are the benefits of istighfar that Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam taught his people. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, you know, there is something that is called Salatu al-Istisqa. When there is no rain. When, for example, in the time of Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, there was a drought. It was drought and there's no rain. And everything is getting dry. There is not enough rain for the harvest. I mean, for the gardens and the vegetables and the fruits. Then we have salah that is called istisqa. And there is a special dua for istisqa, actually. And Sayyidina Umar knows this dua. And he made istisqa before and he recited the dua. And people said, Ameen, Allah, give them rain. But at that situation, Sayyidina Umar didn't make the dua. He just went outside and made istighfar. Astaghfirullah, Allahumma ghafir lana, Allahumma ghafir lana. He asked Allah's forgiveness. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevents His provision, it means we have done something wrong. And we have to return back to Him. So if you look to our situation, our country is back home. Why is this happening? We are Muslimin. We are the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, we're not the people of Allah. There is no any nasab between Allah and the human beings. There is no nasab. There is no any... we are not Allah's relatives, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're just slaves of Him. If you obey him, he will provide for you. If not, he will provide for you, but if he loves you, he will not. He will tell you, you know what? I will not provide for you until you come back to me, because he's merciful. But if he doesn't like you, he will not give you. He will deal with you like with just. But if he loves you, he will tell you, you know what? I will just prevent my provision until you come back to me. So Sayyidina Umar made a lot of istighfar, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showered his rain on the people. Alhamdulillah, people asked him, Ya Umar, مَا رَأَيْنَاكَ اسْتَسْقَيْتُ. You didn't see the dua of istisqa. He said to them, لَقَدْ اسْتَسْقَيْتُ لَكُمْ بِمَجَادِيحِ السَّمَاءِ يَعْنِي بِنُجُومِهَا. He wanted to say, I made the most powerful dua for istisqa, which is istighfar. To ask Allah's provision from the heavens, it's with istighfar. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in a hadith reported by Imam Abi Dawood wa Ibn Majah and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal in his Musnad, قال من لزم الاستغفار جعل الله له من كل ضيق مخرجا ومن كل هم وبلاء فرجا ورزقه من حيث لا يحتسب. If you keep on making istighfar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will solve your problems and will take you out of your difficulties, and he will provide you from whichever ways that you never imagined, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he knows of. Even Sayyidina Hud alayhi salam said the same thing to his people, وَيَا قَوْمِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيَزِدُكُمْ قُوَّةً إِلَىٰ قُوَّتِكُمْ. He will give you strength over the strength that you have, power over your power. And he will يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا. He will shower you with his blessings from the heavens, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something also about the benefits of istighfar is that you can make the shaitan very angry. Because you know what? We always make mistakes and we make him happy. If you want to make him angry, just make a lot of istighfar. He will be so angry, so upset. فَفِي الْحَدِيثِ حَدِيثٌ reported by Imam Al-Hakim. It's authenticated by Imam Al-Albani. أن الشيطان was talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in an authentic Qudsi hadith. And it happened also in the Quran. Shaitan was talking to Rabbil Alameen. So it's not something that we have to prove or anything. So Shaitan was saying to Rabbil Alameen, وَعِزَّتِكَ لَا أَبْرَحُ أُغْوِي عِبَادَكْ مَا دَامَتْ أَرْوَاحُهُمْ فِي أَجِسَدِهِمْ. I swear by you, Ya Allah, that I will remain, I will continue misleading the human beings as long as they are alive, as long as they have their souls and their bodies. فقال الله عز وجل, it doesn't matter. وعزتي وجلالي لا أزال أغفر لهم ما زالوا يستغفرونني. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore with his mighty and his glory, and he said to him, I will continue and remain to forgive them as long as they ask my forgiveness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just ask Allah's forgiveness and he will actually forgive you. Last thing that we'll end up with, inshaAllah ta'ala, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down two safeties, if you can say this, two amanan min as-sama, two safeties from the heavens. One of them is the existence of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the other one is istighfar. And Nabi al-Salam is now in the heavens with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not in the world anymore, but his teaching is still there. قال الله وعلموا أن فيكم رسول الله. Rasulullah is still here with his teaching, subhanahu wa ta'ala. His people is still here. وعلموا أن فيكم رسول الله. Indeed, Rasulullah is amongst you. But he's not here as like with his body, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he's gone now, but istighfar is still there. And the ayah says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. Allah is not going to punish them as long as you are amongst them, Ya Muhammad, and he's gone now. And then Allah, the other option, he will not punish them as long as they make istighfar. So making istighfar is actually so important, and we have some other benefits of istighfar, but I think that's enough to go for our reading part, inshaAllah ta'ala. جزاكم الله خيرا. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.